your standing position, pick up your Bible, Luke chapter 10. In your standing position. Thank you, Jesus. Glory to your name. Thank you, Father.
Jerusalem to Jericho. Now, Geographically, Jerusalem is up, Jericho is down. So he went down. The meaning of that is, as it is geographically, so it is spiritually. On your way down from spirituality to carnality is a registration for the disaster. Every far away from God is nearness to the devil, nearness to the devil. Every reduction in spirituality equals advancement in frustration and calamity. Yes. Anything that takes you away from the presence of God has brought you close to the destruction of the enemy. So, spiritually, as the man went from Jerusalem, on his way to Jericho, he met some thieves. Now, let me also let you know, there are thieves on your way from Jerusalem to Jericho. The sponsorer is called the devil. John 10:10 is the thief. The thief cometh but will steal, kill, and destroy. But I, Jesus, sweet loving Father, glorious Redeemer. He said, I have come to give you life and to give you more abundantly. So every attempt to disconnect from God's presence is registration for frustration. Every step, however, that's why when you come to God's house, I tell you amongst other things, what is happening is that there is restoration taking place. There is impartation taking place. There is visitation taking place. Your faith is growing. Doors are opening. Now, don't trivialize or commonize every time you come and hear God's word. Oh, it's not a religious ritual. It is kingdom divine prescription for your transformation. Please don't joke with it. Don't joke with these things you are hearing and take it casual. Some of you, 5 years after these revelations, you'll be there. You will remember, oh, this man used to say these things. Now I understand what they mean. Some of you now you are in a position where you don't understand. These things God is bringing you to prepare you ahead of time because you need them. Thank you, Jesus. So distance away from God is a registering for the calamity of the enemy. Satan is the sponsor of calamity. He's the chief sponsor. From that scripture, when the man departed from his place, he met the thief, he was harassed, he was defended, he was destroyed. Now, from this scripture, I know that the outcome of the attack of the enemy, because today is a day of restoration, and God is about to restore you.
Amen.
Quickly, what's the outcome of the enemy's attack? What's the outcome of the enemy's attack? The enemy has specialty in attacking and bringing calamity to people. So what are the outcome? Want to look at them quickly. Number one is nakedness, wretchedness, and vulnerability. Nakedness, wretchedness, and vulnerability. That man, we saw the attack, he became wretched. He became, you know, you saw practically, he became vulnerable. He was wretched before the arrival of the surrender. Because of his wretchedness, even the Levite, who was a priest, saw him and passed, he was too wretched to pay attention to him. So, attack of the enemy exposes people to ridicule. Ridicule, frustration. But I prophesy in your life this morning, any form of wretchedness and vulnerability in your life, today they are destroyed in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
Everyone suffering vulnerability, today you shall be restored.
Amen.
Every satanic agenda against your life shall be destroyed this morning.
Amen.
If you are not present, say the loudest amen.
Amen.
Say with me, I shall be clothed with glory. Today is my day of restoration. Number two we saw from that scripture is It brings, remember looking at the outcome of his attack as we saw on this man. Number two is physical infliction with pain, injury, and hurts. Physical infliction, sickness, disease, injury, devotion. That's why I don't care how sick you are today, you'll be healed.
Amen.
The devil does not comfort anyone. His ministry to steal, kill, and destroy. Physical infliction. I mean, if you are inflicted physically with pain, with injury, and hurt. Amen. Every time you are attacked by the devil to bring you injury, every time you are happy and excited and happy and laughing, Satan is angry. Satan hates your joy. He's a manufacturer of sorrow. He's a producer of disaster. He was angry. We saw the outcome. He made that man became inflicted. That's why that Samaritan man took him to the Indian News Hospital. Amen. You see, that's why he didn't be anointed by the Bible to understand what and he said to the medical doctor or the nurse, if you like, take care of this man and take this advanced deposit to carry out the operation from the injury this man is suffering from the teeth that infected him, which is the devil. And I will return back. If you have extra expenses, I will pay for you. You see, that's why God wants to prosper you. Prosperity is not just for a show. I discover, sir, that God will prefer, sorry, Satan will prefer a church to be growing than for a church to prosper. You know why? When the church is growing and there's no prosperity, there's the affliction. Satan would prefer that instead of you to be rich, be healed. Why? If you are blessed, if your sin is personal, if you are blessed, it benefits people. So if you are blessed, you are blessed for people. But if your sin is a personal Christ cross, are we together? Satan is a bastard. Bastard to the thief. You see, you know why that priest, that little guy, you attend to that man, they didn't have the means. Poor party. Are you there? That's why the priest came and saw him. Ah, if I can't just have the hospital, you said, you won't give him the life. Amen? Did you read that scripture I showed you? Powerful, powerful scripture. And by chance, there came a certain priest. He was a pastor, but he never had revelation for prosperity. By the way, and when he saw him, he passed by him the other side. He did that thing, he didn't see it. What a satanic, poverty infested man. You shall prosper. In the name of Jesus. You see, all the kidnapping and all that, they are all programmed by the devil. If you are prosper, why are you kidnapping somebody? Yeah? Answer me. And Satan is responsible. You make you feel that way to get money. That money will bring you to generational calamity.
Yes.
You can't kidnap somebody and expect you have lost your life. It's an insult. You don't fit to live. Anyone who will think to kidnap somebody, is an old dead. His brain is not working well. And of course, Satan is responsible for all the emotional harm of cutting, all the trauma, all the pain, all the limitation, all the emotion. Satan is the sponsorer, he's the manufacturer, he's called the thief. He's one who, was working in those thieves that molested that man. Praise the Lord. But I prophesy your life today. Every demonic hurt in your life, your spirit, your soul, your body shall be wiped off in the name of Jesus. Oh, if somebody believe that, you're going to say better, amen. Say with me, I am going to be free today. I shall never be hurt anymore. I am returning here restored. Say it and believe it. You may God is bringing you to that restoration. And number three thing we saw on that man was attack on his life. Attack on his life. Number three lessons from that scripture. The Bible told us in the next verse, he said, and You know, verse 30. He was wounded and departed, leaving half dead. His life was highly under attack. You see, Satan put him in such a way he could not help himself. Wretchedness, injury, pain, attack on his life. Helplessness. Praise the Lord. Now, another story of some people today. They are so helpless. They can't even meet their needs. They need to beg to feed, beg to pay school fees. Everything, nothing they can do for themselves. They are virtually half dead. Permit me to use that word. There was this, you know, true life story. People came to church and the church was willing to help the widows. They say, if anybody is a widow here, lift up your hands. So the widows lifted their hand. And there's a woman sitting with her husband. She too lifted up her hand. And the husband said, am I dead that you are lifting up your hand? They say, widows. And the woman said, am I better than the widows? Having you is not almost impossible. That devil is a bastard. Today, whatever is bringing calamity to your business, your ministry, your career, is ever destroyed in the name of Jesus. Save me, I'm coming alive. You see, what I'm telling you is true life story. I'm just teaching you this morning. There are some pastors you see there, you say, if this is what it means to be a pastor, I will get to be a pastor. Are we together? There are some Christians, unbelievers say, Christian, you be, I don't better be Christian. Very well, we are supposed to be the light of the world. A city set on a hill that can never be healed. We are supposed to be breakthrough entities. We are supposed to be carriers of God's glory. Please don't get angry with this teaching. It's a restoration revelation. Are we together? God wants you blessed. God wants you prosper. He wants you to live the higher life, the life of the spirit. The life of enjoyment, not suffering and endurance. There are people who are living, their living is just as if though they are just existing. No dramatic relevance, no dramatic turnaround, nothing to show for. Are we together? Because of the enemy. You see their career, nothing to show. Their business, nothing to show. Their family, nothing to show. There are some families you will weep if you really check the picture of what's happening to them at home. You will weep, sir. Husband and wife fighting every day like cat and dog. I mean, problem here and there. As a student, carry over, jump at them everywhere. That's a problem. That's an attack on your career. But today, I don't care wherever that attack is coming from. You shall be restored. Yeah. If you say a better amen, you will answer faster for me. Now, few things I want you to know. As I read this scripture, I saw some things which I'd like to pass across to you. Number one, a few things to know. Ordinary religion has nothing to offer. Ordinary religion has nothing to offer. In other words, no relief from religion. Religion has no relief to offer. Those who follow ordinary religion are not elite. And that's what the problem is with many of our Christianity today. Don't be religious. Have a relationship with Christ. Don't be religious. Have a relationship with Christ. What is religion? Routine activity. Oh, let's go again. Okay. Let us go. Nothing, they are not learning anything, they are not putting anything they are ready to work in their life. A religion. Clap their hands Sunday morning, going out, living like ordinary life. People who didn't hear the word of God. People who didn't want to go are not interested in religion. God is looking for relationship. Look, God wants you to be a partner with Him, like heaven on earth. I mean, you are displaying the life of heaven here on earth as a believer. Not just religion. There are many people also are in church, need qualities in church. Listen to me, qualities will help you in church. Only Christ can help you. Take off your hands from politics and face Christ. Many people, you know.
Thank you, Jesus. Say with me, I don't want to be religious.
I want to be in
a
relationship.
Say with me, I want to face reality.
Relationship. You know your God. You know the testimony of people who knew God. They didn't know the name of the church, whether winners or whether they. For they have to know their God. God is not a Christian. Hello. God is not. And some of you will say, where is this man coming from today? They are going somewhere. You think God is a Christian? The Bible says God is a spirit. Now, it was not God who defined himself as a Christian. It was people who saw people who followed Jesus. They called them Christians. That means they have their nature, their lifestyle.
Yes.
God is a spirit. For they that worship God, must worship him in truth and in spirit. It's not a Christian. It's not a religious man. God is opting for a relationship. Relationship, fellowship, intimacy, koinonia.
Thank you, Jesus.
Thank you.
Number three things I saw, which I saw from that scripture is,
you know, these are so important. The Samaritan woman was not seen as a Christian. The Levites, who are religious people, they saw the man and passed. Which is what we have today in most Christendom. A hero who is standing for the faith will just make one mistake. It is believers that will announce it and scatter the man. Scatter the woman, finish his life and miss it. Unbelievers, they are afraid to talk. Believers, they are number one. Hey, hear what happened today? They are announcers of bad news. Religious people.
I wrote this, I wrote one devotion and I said, I was unveiling the mystery of the prodigal son and his elder brother.
Yes.
The preachers always talk about the prodigal son, but there are some things they skip about the elder brother. That's a long sermon. Amen. Now, number two to know is your deliverance may be the hand of the despised. Your deliverance may be in the hand of the despised. Those who are despised may be the answer to your breakthrough and deliverance. Somebody that you despise today may be the key to your next level. The person you despise today, that's why be careful how you live, how you look at people, how you underrate people. What brought Joseph to the palace, is out of the prison, was the baker. Someone in the someone unremembered. The leprosy of them are left by one, you know, little man who just said, if you are doing a hard thing, would you have done? Why not just do this one and just? He said, okay, let me try. That's how leprosy left. This American was a despised. If the religious people were there, they would have said, don't go close to that man. Are you not a Samaritan? You don't have business there. But God was in to show us his picture. Those who despise, maybe the gateway to your next level, the gateway to your, maybe the helping hand to your, you know, next level. The Jewish priest, the priest was a Jew, because in those days, we never say Samaritan called a Jew, but we had power. No. You know, when Peter saw the revelation, he said, I'm not eating any unclean thing. Jesus said, oh boy, forget that thing. That's what Jesus said to him. He was in the past. He was having a religious mentality. Even when, you know, this man, Cornelius, he said, no, he didn't need salvation to enter the Gentiles. You know, no one ever saw Jesus, like the other disciples who ate with him. They saw faith with Jesus. So but Paul never saw him. As a matter of fact, Paul was in the other side, standing against the move of God. Are we together? Because even when Stephen was killed, people who came to kill Stephen, they put their garments and drop it in the feet of Paul. Paul said, no problem, let me keep it for you. Bam, give those church people who call themselves Christian. Kill them. You will kill them. You know what? You see, that's why fighting is a spirit. It didn't start today, it started from Thursday. If someone wants to fight like a Christian, say you are timing. It is a spirit. Amen? It started before, but there's nothing new under the sun. All you need to do is to position yourself in the direction of light. Those who have succeeded, what made them succeed? What principle did they employ? You know one of the problems we have today, even with the brother of the youth, they don't like process. They don't want to be told the way to the or they want the chapter. Chapter! No. Pastor, pray. Nah. Hot prayer. Pastor says, sit down, let me answer you. He said, no. If you jump the process, you miss the product. You jump the process, you miss. Look, every time you come here and you're hearing the word preached to you, that's the best thing you can. One beloved of the Bible said, I was coming to meet you for a certain cancer, but when I hear the preaching, I said they were going in because they invited me answer my curiosity. I said, yes. I'm happy I'm answering questions when I'm preaching.
Yes, sir.
Are we together?
Yes, sir.
In one preaching of 1 hour, I can answer 100 questions. That's why you must be sensitive and alert. Open up your spirit, man. If you don't open your spirit, nothing may enter. You know why people are not conceiving? They are not pregnant. I told you before, a man and a woman who got married in this setting of Orthodox Church because they were not teaching them what it takes to be. They came from where? Holy Sister Holy and Brother Holy. They don't mean. So they got married 2 years, 4 years, no children. What's happening? They said they don't know. So they came. In the curiosity of the problem, I met the pastor. The pastor said, what's happening? He said, we can't tell. He said, why have you not been pregnant for the past 4 years? What's happening? He said, we don't know, we can't tell. And they did an investigation and discovered that they have been married for the 5 days, they have never met together, they never slept. they said, that pastor, what happened? You are gone? He said, no, we don't do it, we are going. See, they were virgin, sister virgin, brother virgin, pastor virgin. And the man of God said to them, listen, sit down. Open up this thing and you do it. And if you hear it, after that, 1 month after, boom. 9 months after, the manifestation. You see, that's what's happening to many believers, if you hear about that. Many people come to church, their spirit man is closed. They don't come to be pregnant. So when the pastor is prophesying, releasing revelation, they close their mind. They can't be pregnant. They can't conceive. When I even listen to a message that they have preached past, I listen to it as God is talking to me now. I'm praying the prayer inside. Shaka Pukukata, as if God is talking to me now. Because I want to be pregnant. That's why I'm catching visions and dreams and revelation in people. Too many people are too close in their spirit. If you want those scriptures, they will know it, they will help you finish it.
Thank you, Jesus.
Well, let me move on. Number three. Thank you, Jesus. Are you getting this?
Yes.
Am I giving you?
Yes.
Good. Number three. Out of your misery comes your ministry.
Amen.
Wow.
Out of your misery comes your ministry. That man's name came to the book of life out of his misery. Most of the time, the challenges you are going through may be the ministry you are here to solve. The problem you are facing could be the answer to the question you are supposed to answer to your generation. One of the things I picked from that place is that you know why the Samaritan woman stood to attend to that man? Samaritans are rejected people. So inside her misery, she knows how to, comfort people. I don't know if you have had this experience. Your place of frustration gives you attention.
Yes, sir.
Now, personally, there were many years ago, as a pastor, I was wondering how you can pastor even the crowd as they did before. It was a concern to me. And you are anointed, you pray for the sick, things are okay. But you as a pastor, you are poor. What's the problem? And then I discovered you can preach it and not experience it, but you practice it. I adjusted my perspective. You need morning sense. You don't just speak to people to give you too much feedback. So I adjusted. When I adjusted, things changed. I thought as he just preached before, I'll go with us from here. So if God didn't touch you, will God bless you? I left my strength. Amen. Most of the things which I have taught you. Amen. You must know how this thing works. You must have wisdom. You must be a confident practitioner. You must know the principles of money. You must be diligent. You must be disciplined. When money comes to your hand, there is a seed. And of course, there is bread. If you eat your seed, you lack harvest. And all of that, many, many things which I learned. And I just like that. You must have a prophet over your life who's prophesying. Don't just give your this in your mind and see your children away. Who's speaking to you? I learned all those things. They changed. I learned the principles of church growth. I learned it that if church was good, several things were being placed. Number one, you must have life applicable world principle. If you're a home seminar, for example, you just go to your home seminar dry, you're not fresh, you didn't prepare, you didn't have notes to teach. You just go there because slippers, okay. Your words are not seasoned with salt. Your home seminar will not grow. Your church will not grow. That's what most pastors say, you know. Amen. 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 Number two, you must be active in your prayer altar. Don't joke with prayer. Pray for your words like you speak like an oracle. When you say, be blessed, it becomes a command, not a wish. As you say, be blessed, by virtue of the prayers you have prayed, you have generated power. The importance of heaven move and command that word, whoever is listening.
That's right.
That's it. I learned that by experience. Let's move on. When I say, out of your ministry comes your ministry. So that's what we saw in that woman, you know, this American woman. She was one of the outcasts, despised. Her frustration enabled her to connect with another one who was also rejected, while others never saw the need. Abraham, you shall be a father of any nation. And it came to pass, he was a father of no nation. Barrenness, heaven. But that was his problem, that was his mystery. But that's how his ministry came out, father of many nations. Today, all of us are calling Abraham, our father, two of us. Plenty children. Plenty. Abraham was 75 years old. He was poor. How? He was living in his father's house. Eating for his father's house. You know, at 75 years old, could you imagine that in your father's house? You didn't have a house. You didn't have a car. You didn't have anything. 75 years. Bro. I want to hear that. So, came out of his misery, came his ministry. How about Gideon? Gideon was a man who was, you know, presented in the first row. He was afraid. He was under bondage against the Midianites. And God said to him, thou great man of battle. He said, go lead the man, so save Israel. So he had the anointing for deliverance. He was like a deliverance minister, but he was afraid. So what he was afraid of was actually what he was anointed to solve until the angel appeared to him by that character. And he was able to deliver Israel. So his mystery was his ministry. How about Moses? The Egyptian he ran away from was there for saying, get back there. I'm anointed you to go and deliver those people. You were there, but you didn't know understand the answer. Now, let me bring it close to you. Most of the problems or challenges you are going through now, could it be? That's what God has anointed you to solve. Amen.
Amen.
Maybe you are feeling sick now. God has given you the anointing for healing and deliverance. Maybe your relationship is breaking here and there. God is saying, sister, sit down. I've anointed you to be an experience, an example for nations to show them how this thing works. Are we together? I pray for you today. Every misery around your life shall bring you testimony.
Yeah.
And that amen is louder if you answer faster.
Yeah.
Number 14 you must know is that compassion is the doorway to both unction and provision. Compassion is the doorway to both unction. Unction means anointing. And provision. That's supernatural supply. You see, lack of compassion is the reason for absence of oil and mantle and supplies and restoration. Compassion! the doorway
to both unction and provision. I'm sure you're taking it down. Let me explain it a little while. You see, how compassionate are you with the final type of putting in your hand on us?
The Samaritan woman was compassionate.
So God gave her the mantle to give to deliver. Put the resources in her hand. Now, if you don't have a vision, if you think that God wants to prosper you just for you for your, and your family, you may never see. But if you have a vision, you know that God wants you to be a kingdom financier to, you know, to use it to fulfill your dream, your vision, your assignment, then the necessity for the need will come, then God will become committed.
How compassionate are you? Do you just think of you and yourself?
Those priests who saw him and walked past from the scripture we read, they were selfish. They were not compassionate. So the oil to deliver was not given to them.
Deliverance! Not compassionate!
So the mantle was not given to him.
Provisions and submission. God will supply for every vision that he gives.
One of the secrets of abundance is to cast vision.
Cast vision.
When you cast a dream, God begins to show you what step to take. How it will divinely and naturally answer. He said, you know, provision is two words, provide and vision. So if you don't have vision, there's no providing.
For my God shall supply
all your needs according to his name. Am I speaking to you today? Now God spoke to me that one of the things he will restore today is he will restore your spiritual eyes and ear.
Amen.
I mean, that's what God said.
Amen.
Secondly, he said, I will release the anointing for excellence.
Amen.
I wrote it down. Pray. Let it direct it again. Number one, I will restore your spiritual ears. And I will restore anointing for them to excel will fall on them.
Amen.
Amen. You see, there is an anointing that makes you excel. Excel came from the word excellence. Excellence came from the word excel. That means exceptionally good. Outstandingly perfected in what you do. You need it, sir. You use that thing to do business, you succeed. Use it to do ministry, you succeed. Use it to do academics. You're just at the top. Praise the Lord. Now, strength of your hands. Make your words that God has spoken concerning your spiritual eyes and ears. Restoration
in the name of Jesus. And I pray that the anointing to yourself fall upon you now in the name of Jesus.
Thank you, Father.
Thank you, Lord.
In Jesus' name.
Amen.
Number five, okay? Because then I'm going to stop there, but remember I said compassion is the doorway to both unction and provision. In other words, provision talks about resources. God will give you resources from your compassion. Will give you what it takes to accomplish it.
Restoration, answer to compassion.
And of course, last, for a lesson I saw there is that compassion is the doorway to restoration.
Compassion is the doorway.
Remember, it's a covenant of restoration. I'm showing you compassion.
How is gateway to restoration?
In other words, you can't have it in your heart and not have it in your hands.
Once you have it in your heart, you will have it in your hands.
Do you have heart to help people? God will give you what it takes.
We have declared operation, befriend your neighbor.
The next question is that you really have a heart for souls. I told one of my neighbors yesterday when I came down to open. Okay, I was coming in and, you know, called on attention to say, you know, to check something in the fuse or the meter or something. I said, listen, come here. Next Sunday is somebody's wife. I said, next Sunday you're going to church with me. She said, yes, sir. Next Sunday you're going to church with me. Amen.
Compassion, because I saw need for Jesus to come into our life.
I've not had a chance, you know, to spend time to talk to them because I'm so traveler. Go out in the morning, come out in the night, no time at all. Now that download operation by all means has been declared, your neighbor has been declared. Amen. Praise God. And I've met it. She has been agreed. So nothing has stopped it.
Somebody shout hallelujah! So that's what we mean, compassion. If you have it, if you are compassionate, it will answer. As I close this morning, I want to conclude with some vital keys that provoke your restoration. Other vital keys that activate your restoration. Number one, I'm going to be very fast, I'm going to be praying. Number one key is aggressive prayer. Aggressive prayer. Oh God, restore my health. Oh God, restore my finance. Oh God, restore my mental dignity. Oh God, restore my spiritual life. In the civil service, I'll be showing you dimensions of restoration. Oh, that's so powerful. Because there are areas of restoration you need. More than 10 areas. 10, I'll show you in the second service. Then I'll show you 4 types of restoration. Not just restoration, there are dimensions. And we will again show you why you need restoration. That's in the second service. But I'm just quick to make it up. Number one is aggressive prayer. You pray. You didn't create me to be a bad accident. Lord, what's the path? Reveal it. We saw Jabez, God restored in the place of prayer, aggressive prayer. You see, you do nothing about your life, God will respond. You watch you the way you watch yourself. Take your life serious. Praise the Lord. Aggressive prayer. Aggressive prayer. Aggressive prayer. Aggressive prayer. There are people today under the sound of my voice. I want you to pray when we rise to pray aggressively. How?
Aggressive.
How?
Aggressive.
Don't pray normally, prayer normal. Pray the fighter's prayer. What do I call it? Be ruggedized in your prayer. Don't be gentle. The gentle lose it. The violent. Take it. How? Have you seen a man who takes things by force that you get? If I try to drag your man like this, you refuse, will you come out? But if I do like this, before you know you are out, two of us. God bless you. Amen. So aggressive prayer. Jacob also, God is restoration by being aggressive in his prayer. I will never let you go until you bless me. He said, they will soon don't know. I don't stay out for the day. He said, they will don't with me and you here. Genesis 32, verse 24. Down to 26. Nobody they will don't. Night will fall again with me and you here. And then they said, okay, please, God, make you go best. What do you want? He said, bless me. He said, okay, now be blessed. His prayer was answered. Because it was aggressive. Some of you pray a prayer of, oh God, if you like, answer, if you don't like, what do you mean by that? That's why there's no answer. You must be brutal. What does it? Karabashata, ikopodoto sholama. If your tongues, you understand it, you are not praying. Hey, hello, Chef Victoria. What are you saying? I don't know. I was not designed to know. I was just prompted by scripture to be rocked and brutalized. Shout hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
We saw David also. If God is restoration, you see, scriptures are examples for us. They are frontliners, they are pathfinders, they are examples. Are we together? God doesn't know whether you are white or you are black. He's by himself say, there is no Jew, there is no Greek. Everyone that accepts him, that fears him, is acceptable before him. God doesn't have a special. You can only make yourself special before God. How is that?
First
Samuel chapter 30 and verse 8. We saw the experience of David. He wrought out his restoration by intercession. He went and inquired of the Lord And the Bible told us, pursue, overtake, you shall surely recover all. Recover means restoration. Are we together? If you get over 16 and 18, you recover his steward that was collected, his voice, his goods, and all of that. So you need aggressive prayer. Of course, number two, you need obedience. Obedience of faith. Whatever I tell you to do it. Disobedience will rob you of restoration. You need to be obedient. Be an obedient child of God. Number two, obedience is a turning point of destiny. When you obey God, sir, restoration will respond to you. What more? Walk in love. Walk in love. Walk in love. Compassion. Compassion. How did Job come to his restoration? His compassion. For eyes have not seen, ears have not heard, that has been touched in the heart of my own home. You know, keep protection and love it. That means I hear sacred testimonies. I have not seen. That means kind of testimony that eyes have not been able to see. Strange things happen to you by the qualification of your love. Your love brings you to a magnet with divine attention. Magnet. Thank you, Jesus. What number is that? Number three. Number four is prophetic intervention. Prophetic intervention. God anoints prophets to provoke restoration. This is important. Many people have not received their prophet to their restoration has not come. It's God's ordained formula. It's not the thing of age. It's not even a thing of grace. It's not election. It is absolutely by what we call grace, election of grace. What is grace? Access by only divine qualification. Not effort, not ability, not capacity. Hello? By a prophet, the Lord brought Israel out of Egypt, and by a prophet, they were preserved. Permit me, you are a covered by a prophet. They were there for 430 years of the prophet arrived, they were recovered. Thank you, Jesus. And of course, lastly, is you must repent. Repentance. The prodigal son returned back. Luke chapter 15, from verse 11. And when he returned, he was restored. So until you return to God, it's not your turn to be restored. The Bible says he came to himself. Go to the next verse. And as he returned, the younger brother, you know, give the person to the next verse. Thank you, Jesus. And when he came to himself, good, he said, how many higher servants of my father's house have bread enough to spare and to perish in your way hunger? You see, that's why you must learn how to think your way through. Don't only pray through, think through. He came to his senses. And he said, arise and go back to my father in return. And I will say to him, I have sinned against heaven and heaven before thee. Even if you don't take me as a son again, you take me as a servant, no problem. But the Bible says the father rose up and went and embraced him. Restoration. And killed the father's calf for him. That's why the elder brother was angry. You mean I was able to kill the father's calf for me, and you are giving it to someone who has not to waste your resources for misfortune? The question we should have asked is that what stopped you from collecting your home, the elder brother? But the lesson also to learn is the fact that he returned. Most of you need to return. Stop doing religion. Be in Christ. Be in Christ. You can be coming to church for donkey years if you're not applying the principle change in your thought. I'm going to say it. But you cannot be in Christ and not be restored. He says, come unto me only that live and heavy living, I will give you rest. I prophesy your life. Whatever Satan has stolen from you shall be recovered now! In the name of Jesus! Everyone of God sick, you shall be healed right now! In the name of Jesus! You didn't receive anything. Jump up on your feet to the last. Do you receive anything?
Yes, sir.
Are you sure you believe?
Yes.
Jump up on your feet. Oh. Lift up your hands and give glory to God. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Bless his name. Adore him. Give him praise. Give him glory. Give him honor and adoration. Thank you, Father. In Jesus' precious name.